We'll start now. Hello everyone, welcome to the 8th KCIPM PATH webinar, and this time it will be on a DermPath topic. The session will be moderated by Dr. Inchira YK. She's an associate professor at St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. I thank all the audience at this point for supporting us and being with the KCIPM PATH webinar series all along. This is reflected in the number of subscribers we have. We are just 28 subscribers away from the 4,000 subscriber mark. So hopefully we will cross that during this webinar. So kindly subscribe and follow our KCIPM social media channel to get automatically notified every time we go live. Without me wasting much time, I'll now hand over the session to Dr. Inchira YK to introduce about the topic and introduce our speaker for the day. Inchira ma'am.
Yes, thank you Dr. Aditya, and I take this opportunity to thank KCIAPM for giving this wonderful teaching learning opportunity online. And as you're all aware, today's topic is a diagnostic approach to cutaneous vesiculobullous diseases. Vesiculobullous diseases, as you all know, forms a major chunk of inflammatory dermatopathology in our routine clinical practice, and often as histopathologists, we do face dilemmas and we have to lean on ancillary techniques. In the recent years, with the immense advances in ancillary techniques, it becomes important for us to keep abreast with the recent advances and also use them effectively in our routine diagnostic practice. So we have this topic today, and we encourage all the viewers to give in your comments, and there might be questions, so you can give your answers and you can also send in your queries. Please make use of this opportunity to the maximum. And it is my immense pleasure and privilege to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Rajalakshmi Tirumalai. Dr. Rajalakshmi Tirumalai is professor of pathology at St. John's Medical College, Bengaluru. She has completed her fellowship in dermatopathology from Germany. She has several awards, grants, and publications to her credit. And she's a very passionate teacher and mentor. She has conducted several workshops and CMEs to promote dermatopathology. She is an office bearer for the Dermatopathology Society of India and chief editor of Indian Journal of Dermatopathology and Diagnostic Dermatology. With this, I invite Dr. Rajalakshmi to present her talk on diagnostic approach to cutaneous vesiculobullous diseases. Dr. Rajalakshmi, over to you.
Rajalakshmi, ma'am. Hello. Rajalakshmi, ma'am, kindly share your presentation and please start.
Is it visible now?
Yes, ma'am. Can we speak? Yes. Please go ahead.
Beginning? Can we begin?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much, and welcome to everyone who's sitting in this webinar on diagnostic approach to. As we know, various diseases of have to those with an autoimmune basis and those with to tell. Today's talk, we will be focusing that have an autoimmune basis, and at times when it is necessary to consider differential diagnosis, we will look at a few of the non-immune diseases. Now coming of autoimmune blistering diseases, we know that they are increasing in incidence owing to increase in life expectancy, They have a significant impact on the quality of life. They are at risk for mortality. Many of them, such as pemphigus vulgaris, paraneoplastic pemphigus, and toxic epidermal necrolysis, constitute dermatologic emergencies. Also, they are associated with neurological diseases. Sometimes they are paraneoplastic. An explosion of knowledge has taken place, understanding molecular mechanism this. Amongst all autoimmune diseases, I must say that autoimmune blistering diseases now know the target antigens for most of them, and we also have very specific investigations that can unveil the same. And of late, you have options. Diagnostic accuracy. Steps to diagnose autoimmune diseases. First big step is a clinical evaluation. Now, the information that's important for us when we look clinically at these lesions is what is the age of the patient. For example, if it's a very elderly patient, you will think of bullous pemphigoid. If it's a young patient, you will think of a linear IgA disease. Whether the bullae are flaccid or tense. Now, flaccid blisters tend to occur in vulgaris, whereas tense blisters are seen in subepidermal diseases such as pemphigoid. What is the pattern of distribution of? Is there mucosal involvement, which is very often seen in pemphigus vulgaris, and the presence of pruritus? These are the ways to evaluate these patients clinically. Coming to histopathology, although it's believed that the role of histopathology is limited, it gives us very important information such as the level of the blister, the mechanism by which the blister has formed, and the inflammatory cell content. The next two steps are what confirm the diagnosis, that is direct immunofluorescence followed by indirect IF, ELISA, and immunoblot, which are available commercially for quite a few of the antibodies. Now, first, let's get the definitions straight. We say vesiculobullous, but very often what we see under the microscope is a vesicle, which is less than 5 millimeter in diameter. And a bulla that's pretty large usually is not biopsied. If at all you need to biopsy a bulla, you need to do an incisional biopsy. Now, coming to the biopsy techniques, more often than not, we end up seeing punch biopsies. So how does one take a biopsy? For histopathology, if it's a very small blister, whereas if it's a large blister, it's better to direct the along with a bit of the blister. This is done so as to avoid shearing off of the roof, pulling out sample or during processing. And one very important tip for the residents while grossing, do not bisect the blister. Samples for direct immunofluorescence, all of us know that we need to take perilesional skin. That is, in all cases, except in dermatitis herpetiformis, we move a little away and we try to take the normal skin around the vesicle for DIF. Now, coming to the location of the blisters, we know that they could be intraepidermal, they could be subepidermal, or they could be both. And sometimes, because of the process of regeneration within the blisters, that could be a confounding factor for you to say where the blister is exactly located. Next comes the mechanism of blistering. Among the intraepidermal blisters, the most important mechanism is this is followed by spongiosis and ballooning. In subepidermal blisters, we talk about immunobullous and mechanobullous diseases. That there is antigen antibody reaction at the basement membrane, which elicits the inflammatory cells, which causes dissolution of the junction. Then there are structural genetic alterations in mechanobullous diseases, such as the epidermolysis bullosa, which we will not see these today. Then dermal edema and extensive vascular alteration can cause subepidermal blister. Now let's look a little bit at the anatomy of the dermoepidermal junction. All of us know that desmosomes are what bind the keratinocytes together. And here we have the desmoglines 1 and 3 and desmocolins, which are transmembrane glycoproteins. And these are linked to the plakins, which are situated within the cytoplasm. And this is responsible for the pemphigoid group of diseases. Coming to basement membrane zone, we know that there is a lamina lucida, lamina denser, and a sublamina denser. And you see two important antibodies, that is the BP20, which is again a transmembrane protein, and you have the BP230, which are important in the pemphigoid group of diseases, the integrins, which again are seen in pemphigoid, and then you have the laminins and type 7 collagen, which are in the lamina densa and the deep part of the lamina lucida, which are responsible for epidermolysis bullosa, acquisita, and the bullous LE group of diseases. Now, this lamina lucida is a very important layer for that, as this is the most fragile layer and through which we can do something and induce blistering. So we will look at this a little later, but just remember the structure of the dermoepidermal junction. Now, there's a long list of autoantibodies that are associated with autoimmune blistering diseases. These are broadly divided into the pemphigus, the subepidermal diseases, broadly divided into the pemphigoid group, which includes the variant pemphigoid, DBA, and the linear IgA disease, whereas dermatitis herpetiformis is different. Now, we will look at examples of these, so we will know, we will understand them better. Now, comparing the immunodiagnostic techniques that are commercially available, direct immunofluorescence is still considered the gold standard for many diseases with a good sensitivity and specificity. It's a one-step procedure. It's relatively easy to perform. The limitations are that you need to take an additional tissue sample, which may not be feasible, especially when the patient has only oral lesions. It's of limited value in subepidermal diseases and does not distinguish between the subtypes of pemphigus. Indirect IF, of course, has enhanced sensitivity in the subepidermal blistering diseases. All you need is a single serum sample, so you could do it in a case where biopsies are not feasible. But the limitations are that it requires a lot of different substrates from human and animal sources. It's a two-step procedure, and if the antibody titer is low, you could get a false negative result. ELISA and immunoblot are the new kids on the block. So you have ELISAs for quite a few of the antibodies that are available. Although these are specific, these are expensive, as often you need to do multiple assays, and this is not easily available everywhere. Now, the comparison between direct and indirect immunofluorescence. Direct immunofluorescence detects the tissue-bound antibodies, whereas the indirect immunofluorescence detects the circulating autoantibodies. And for this, you require unfixed tissue, whereas you could do it on serum, you could do it on EDTA samples, citrate, plasma, any heparin plasma, any of these samples, you could do an indirect IF. How do you send a sample for direct immunofluorescence? You know that you have to sample from the perilesional skin. Now, the most popular transport medium is the Michel's medium nowadays, because the samples remain stable for up to 30 days at room temperature. Prepared, the Michel's medium itself is stable 6 months, but the problem with Michel's is that if not washed adequately before staining, you get a lot of background. The best actually is normal saline, because it washes away the unbound immunoglobulin, but it has to reach the lab and be processed very rapidly, that is within 24 hours, and this is not feasible if your lab is in a different city. Now, Dr. Rao group from Manipal tried out honey as an alternative transport medium, and they found pretty good results. So they found that the sample remains stable for up to 2 weeks. So this is inexpensive, easily available. However, it is not suitable for dermatitis herpetiformis, as they become negative. And of course, this again needs extensive validation before it is accepted universally. And stained and unstained slides can both be stored at minus 20 degrees for a long time. In our department, we have stored slides for almost 2 years, and there's significant quenching of the fluorescence if they are stored properly. Coming to the interpretation of DIF, we look at four important things. First is, where is the location of the fluorescence? What is the pattern of the fluorescence? Which are the immunoreactants? Commonly, we do IgG, IgA, IgM, and C3, and sometimes C1Q, depending on what the question is. And the intensity is graded from 1 to 4 plus. It's subjective, and each lab has its own set of parameters. Now, coming to the intraepithelial patterns of fluorescence, so this is also called as the fishnet or the intercellular pattern. The most common immunoreactants that we encounter are IgG with or without C3, And Dr. this is Shuma? Characterized in the pemphigus group of diseases.
Yeah.
Then now we have the
Start from interpretation of DIF. The slides were not moving initially, that's why.
Okay. Yeah, so let me go back to this. So for the interpretation of DIF, we look at four important things. That is the location of the fluorescence, the pattern of the fluorescence, what immunoreactants are there, and the intensity. Now, the immunoreactants commonly the IgM and C3, and sometimes C1Q if the question is, and the intensity is graded from 1+ to 4+. This, of course, could be a little subjective. Now, coming to the patterns of intraepithelial fluorescence, which is also called as the fishnet or the intercellular pattern, this is characteristic of the pemphigus group of diseases. So IgG with or without C3 is what is seen most commonly in pemphigus. And please note that it does not really differentiate between vulgaris and foliaceous. I mean, I know there are there's literature which says that foliaceous stains more at the top and pemphigus vulgaris more at the bottom, but that's not really a reliable feature. Now, there is IgA pemphigus, in which you get intercellular positivity for IgA. If you have a conjunction of a fishnet pattern with the basement membrane zone pattern, the possibility that you have to think paraneoplastic pemphigus and pemphigus erythematosus. Coming to the basement membrane patterns of fluorescence, you have three important patterns: the linear, the glassy, and the granular. The linear pattern is what we see commonly for C3 and IgG. This is seen in the pemphigoid group of diseases as well as the epidermolysis bullosa acquisita. Linear positivity for IgA, which we see in linear IgA disease, also called as chronic bullous dermatosis of childhood. A glassy positivity of the vessel walls and sometimes the basement membranes is seen in porphyria. And a granular positivity for IgA is what characterizes dermatitis herpetiformis. And if you have to, you have to think of an LE. Now, coming to indirect immunofluorescence, you are available. The monkey esophagus substrate is the most sensitive substrate for the pemphigus group of diseases. If you do immunofluorescence, about 10% of healthy people can show positivity, so that has to be in the correct clinical context. The human salt split or the monkey salt split is a very useful substrate to differentiate the pemphigoid group from the other subepidermal group of diseases. The rat bladder expresses plakins very highly, so that's a good substrate for paraneoplastic pemphigus. Of late, people have started using toad skin to differentiate certain variants of bullous pemphigoid versus EBA because toad skin lacks collagen 7. Primate liver could be used to demonstrate the sinusoidal pattern of anti-intomycial antibodies in dermatitis herpetiformis. And recently, patients of inherited EB, the skin has been taken from them which lack laminin and collagen, which are used to differentiate EBA and BP. Of course, this is not very widely used. But the main fluorescence is that availability and standardization of so many substrates is very difficult, and validation is a big problem. In our lab, what we follow is this biochip indirect immunofluorescence test. Now, this is a titer plane technique. It has the advantage that you just need a single serum sample that allows you to simultaneously detect the common antigens, and you get the chip with 6 and 11 substrates. So what we do is the dermatology mosaic biochip, which has 6 substrates: the monkey esophagus, human salt split skin, desmoglines 1 and 3, and the BP 180 and 230. And with this, you can solve most of the common bullous diseases. And the advantage is that you can run up to 10 samples at a time, depending on the volume load. We will look at examples where we have used this to solve certain clinical problems later on during the presentation. Now, having said this, morphology still remains the cornerstone for us to approach bullous diseases. So as I said earlier, based on the location, we could divide them into intraepidermal and subepidermal diseases. Now, based on the mechanism, intraepidermal diseases are further classified into acantholytic and non-acantholytic. And in acantholytic diseases, the level of the split is important, whether it's suprabasal or subcorneal. Subepidermal diseases, similarly, can be classified into inflammatory or post-inflammatory or cell poor. And if it's inflammatory, we have to see what cells predominate, whether it's eosinophils, whether it's neutrophils, or they are lymphocytic. Let's begin with the intraepidermal acantholytic group of diseases. As you know, we have two major groups, the suprabasal blisters and the subcorneal or intragranular blisters. Now, this is very easy. This is a very classical picture which is showing a suprabasal acantholytic blister. You can see that the acantholysis is also extending into the hair follicles here. There is dermal inflammation and you can clearly see the acantholytic cells, and this is the row of tombstones appearance. You can see the dermal papillae that are exaggerated and they are covered by a row of basal keratinocytes. You could see some amount of inflammation in the dermis. Involvement of the hair follicles, the acrosyringium, the sebaceous units is a hallmark of this disease, and that is what you're seeing here. And the result of this is that you often see free floating hair shafts and sebocytes. So even if you don't see the adnexal structures in the biopsy, if you see these within the blister cavity, that's a clue that this disease is showing adnexal involvement. And what's more interesting to me in bullous diseases is to look at the adjacent epidermis rather than the vesicle itself. So here we see that there is a lot of spongiosis. And the clue to this disease comes from this feature, that is the neutrophils and eosinophils sticking to the cell junctions between the desmosomes, because that's where all the action is. So IF shows the classic fishnet pattern with IgG and C3, and clinically this presents with very fragile blisters and erosions, and this is a rare instance of where there's an intact blister within the mucosa. Usually it doesn't remain intact, and this of course is pemphigus vulgaris. What we have to remember is that pemphigus vulgaris sometimes present only with urticarial lesions, in which case you see spongiosis. Now, indirect IF with monkey esophagus substrate is very sensitive for pemphigus vulgaris. And ELISA for desmogline 1 and 3, although it's not necessary for diagnosis, it is useful in the follow-up as it is used to determine the management. So this is something which has become more popular, and there are many dermatologists who request for desmogline ELISAs. One important point that you have to bear in mind is that very often, because of the regeneration, a suprabasal blister can appear intraepidermal. So if you really go to the edge and notice, you see this subtle acantholysis happening in the suprabasal areas. So the location of the blister should not mislead you. Regenerative changes can occur in the form of nuclear. So you should not mistake this for an acantholytic SCC. And you could have multinucleation, which could mimic herpes virus inclusions. So the help for you comes from a positive DIF, and there are instances where the multinucleation has been so reminiscent of herpes that we've even done herpes serology. So that's not a bad idea to do that, particularly in oral lesions. Now, this was a case that presented actually to our surgical oncologist, and they thought it was a verrucous carcinoma. To our surprise, when we received the biopsy, we saw that the epidermis is very hyperplastic, but you do see the suprabasal acantholysis here. And this again was indirect IF was positive. So this is a variant which is pemphigus vegetans, which has very hyperplastic and vegetative lesions. What do you see here? You see subcorneal pustules. In fact, you don't see any vesicles or bulla. So if you see subcorneal pustules, what are the diseases that you will think of, right? Subcorneal pustular dermatosis, pustular psoriasis, right? But this is a variant of pemphigus that we have to keep in mind, which is the IgA pemphigus. So this patient had a 2+ intercellular positivity for IgA, and all the other immunoreactants were negative. And if you look at it, the acantholysis is very, very subtle and minimal. So that's one of the hallmarks of this disease. This is IgA pemphigus. It presents as a pustular dermatitis rather than a blistering disease. The next disease that we are looking at, you see the difference in acantholysis between the previous case and this case. Acantholysis is not just confined to the suprabasal region, but it is also extending almost up to the stratum granulosum. And what is very classical under hyper is the appearance of the acantholytic cells. They have very brightly eosinophilic perinuclear cytoplasm, and the periphery is very pale gray stained, right? And the nuclei, in contrast to those of pemphigus, they are not pycnotic, they still look viable. So this is the classic pattern of acantholysis that you get in Hailey-Hailey disease. And you contrast that with the acantholysis in pemphigus, it looks very different, right? So this is Hailey-Hailey disease, which is an inherited disease. It's a mutation in the ATPC2C1 gene, as a result of which there is dysregulated adhesion. Now, the main difference from pemphigus is in the level of acantholysis, and of course the pattern, the cells retain the polygonal shape in Hailey-Hailey disease. You do not get adnexal involvement, and of course the DIF is always negative. This is just another important point, is that Hailey-Hailey disease is not clinically blistering, and it presents as plaques in the flexures, in the axillae and groins. This is another mimic of pemphigus. What you're seeing here is a thick parakeratotic column, and there is suprabasal clefting, and there are these cells which usually you don't see in pemphigus. What are these? These are the dyskeratotic cells, which is the reference to try to identify chorons and grains. So this is a choron, so this has a halo around the nucleus, and this is a grain which looks like a parakeratotic cell, which is slightly plumper. So these are chorons and grains, which are classically seen in this disease, which presents with keratotic papules. This is Darier's disease. This is a genodermatosis, which is a consequence of the mutations in ATPA2 genes, resulting in the loss of plaquins. Nail and mucosal involvement is also known. So what you get here is suprabasal clefting with acantholytic dyskeratosis, and of course immunofluorescence is negative. Sometimes you can get a positive family history. A close differential of Darier disease is Grover's disease. Grover's disease is not actually an autoimmune blistering disease, it's an inflammatory disease. What you see here is suprabasal acantholysis with a dermal lichenoid infiltrate. Usually it has, you know, eosinophils, but in this particular case the eosinophils are not very. And again, you see keratotic cells and pemphigus-like areas. So Grover's has a variable histopathology. It can vary within the same specimen. So the differences between Darier's and Grover's disease are summarized here. Darier's, usually you do not get spongiosis. Grover's, you do get spongiosis. Inflammation is sparse in Darier. It can be prominent in Grover's. And the typical feature of Grover's is that you have more than one pattern of acantholysis occurring within a single biopsy. Moving on to the intragranular or subconial group of diseases, you can clearly make out that the split is higher up in this case. You see a thin layer of stratum corneum and stratum granulosum, whereas here you see a nice intraepidermal vesicle with very few acantholytic cells. Now, if you look at this biopsy, this looks almost normal. It looks like there's nothing happening in the epidermis. But if you go higher, you notice that this is because the roof is so fragile that it has been shed off. And you see these knobby outlines of keratinocytes. So that tells you that the split is higher up. This is what it looks like. It's seborrheic distribution, fragile blisters and erosions. This is pemphigus foliaceus. The DIF is similar to what you see in pemphigus vulgaris. So you could either get intragranular clefts or intraepidermal vesicles. DIF, you get IgG and C3 in the intercellular space. And ELISA is positive for desmoglein 1. The differential diagnoses include impetigo. If you find bacteria, you could demonstrate them using the Gram stain. And if it's occurring in an infant or a child and you don't see bacteria and you see this pattern of acantholysis, you have to think of staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome. See, these are the important differentials for pemphigus foliaceus. Okay, so now we're going to have a quiz. This is a lady who presented with extensive involvement of the lip. She has chelitis. You can also see she has ocular involvement. She has these tiny blisters. She has some erythematous targetoid lesions, and she has lichenoid lesions. This is what her biopsy showed. I'm sorry for the quality of the sections. This is an old case. You don't see the roof of the blister at all. All you see is the floor, which has an exaggerated villus pattern. It is lined by some cells. And you have this dense lichenoid infiltrate, which is going quite deep. And you can see here, there is acantholysis, and you also see the lymphocytic infiltrate. And this is what the immunofluorescence showed. The IgG showed an intercellular as well as basement membrane zone positivity. And the C3 had only a basement membrane positivity. So I will wait for you to type in your diagnosis for this case.
Requesting audience to type in the answers in the chat box. We'll give you 30 seconds for that. Ma'am, Dr. Chaitra, Dr. Rohini, Dr. Shivangi, Dr. Rashmi Jindal, all of them are for paraneoplastic pemphigus. Okay. And Dr. Chaitra Naveen has now changed the answer to bullous mucous erythematosus.
Okay, right. So I think they're on the right track. So that is definitely looking like paraneoplastic pemphigus. So these patients present with stomatitis, chelitis, and in fact, the mucosal lesions can be very extensive and cutaneous involvement can be completely absent. Clinically, it is more in common with erythema multiforme rather than the pemphigus group of diseases, and there's an obligate association with malignancy. This patient, in fact, later on, we found that she had a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So the characteristic of paraneoplastic pemphigus is intraepidermal acantholysis, inflammation, and of course DIF shows a combination of the intercellular as well as the basement membrane zone pattern. However, remember that histopath and DIF are not definitive. So what you need to use is the rat bladder substrate for indirect IF, which is very specific but unfortunately not very sensitive, right? So that is the best substrate. And you have ELISA for plakins that are available, so that can be utilized in order to prove the diagnosis. But usually the search for malignancy is fruitful, and that itself proves the diagnosis. So this is a presumptive paraneoplastic pemphigus. So that is right. So let's move on to the next group of diseases, which are the intraepidermal spongiotic disease. What you see in this case, blister, not much happening in the adjacent epidermis, is going quite deep. If you focus on the infiltrate, you see that it's rich in eosinophils in the deeper as well as the superficial portions. And if I tell you that this is from a young patient from an exposed site, the most obvious answer is arthropod bite reaction. And sometimes you could have degenerative changes in the collagen because of the saliva of the insect if it is actually bitten at that point. And this mimics bullous pemphigoid. Sometimes it mimics drug eruption. Again, the history, the short history, the young age of the patient, the occurrence on exposed sites, and of course, a negative DIF, all this will give you a clue to the diagnosis. Okay, we have the second quiz now. This is an infant girl who presented with vesicles all over since birth, and later on, she had some hyperpigmented lesions. You can see she still has a couple of intact vesicles. And over here, you notice the hyperpigmentation has set in. And this is what the histopathology showed. There were multiple intraepidermal vesicles. One of them has become caught up in the edge of the biopsy, but you see there are tiny vesicles. And you see there are a lot of eosinophils. They are in the epidermis as well as the dermis. And moving a little away from the spongiosis, you see these cells. So there are a lot of dyskeratotic cells. You see, they have shrunken, deeply eosinophilic cytoplasm and pycnotic nuclei. At the same time, they don't look like the chorons and the grains that we saw in Darier disease or Grover's disease. So can I ask the audience to give their diagnosis?
Audience will have 30 seconds. Kindly respond in comment section. Ma'am, Dr. Rashmi Jindal, Dr. Rohini, Dr. Leena, and Dr. Shivangi, all are for incontinentia pigmenti. Dr. Nalini Bansal, ma'am, is for genodermatitis incontinentia pigmenti. And Dr. Rohini is for villus lupus erythematosus.
All right. Okay, so I think most of them have got it right. So that is indeed the vesicular stage of incontinentia pigmenti, which is an X-linked dominant genodermatosis. Now, if you biopsy, there are only hyperpigmented or atrophic and hypopigmented lesions, all you will see is post-inflammatory pigmentation. So if the biopsy is taken during the vesicular or the verrucous stage, you have a chance for making the diagnosis. Otherwise, it's a diagnosis of clinicopathologic correlation. Right. Now we will move on to the next group, that is the intraepidermal ballooning diseases. I think this is very, very classical. So what you have here is ballooning of keratinocytes as well as reticular alteration. It's an intraepidermal blister. And the three M's, the multinucleation, margination, and molding, which exemplify the viral cytopathic effect of herpes simplex, are quite obvious in this. So what we have to remember is that sometimes, especially in herpes incognito, you could get a very dense lymphocytic infiltrate. The inclusions may not be very prominent, nor the vesicles, but you get a lot of lymphocytic infiltrate around the follicles and eccrine units, and you could even have lymphocytes that appear atypical. So again, serology, clinical path correlation, that's what comes to the rescue. Right, so this is a summary of the intraepidermal group of blistering diseases that we looked at. So we've seen examples of acantholytic, spongiotic, and ballooning. So I think we've covered most of the common diseases that we see in practice. With this, we will move on to the subepidermal group of diseases. As I told you earlier, these are broadly classified based on morphology into inflammatory and posi-inflammatory diseases. Now, coming to the inflammatory diseases, which are rich in eosinophils. So what you're seeing here is a subepidermal blister. There are eosinophils within the blister as well as in the dermis surrounding it. And if you move a little away, you see that there is a lot of spongiosis and dermal eosinophils. And what is very nice is this clue, that is the eosinophils sticking to the basement membrane. This is a very good clue to recognizing this condition in all stages of the disease, including the urticaria. And if you do a DIF, you see a linear basement membrane zone pattern with C3 with or without IgG. And what you see clinically are very tense blisters, no mucosal involvement. This is very classical of bullous pemphigoid. Bullous pemphigoid is a disease of the elderly, and very often they don't present with blisters. In fact, they could just come with long-standing pruritus or articarial plaques that are refractory to treatment. So it's very important to have a clinical index of suspicion and do a DIF in these cases. More than 50% of cases are associated with neurologic disease. There are anecdotal reports of association with malignancy, but this has not been confirmed. Now, there are certain cell poor variants which mimic epidermolysis bullosa acquisita. And in such cases, one has to resort to doing a salt split skin. On ELISA, they are positive for BP180 and 230. And off late, there's a thought that BP180 is a predictive biomarker of recurrence in bullous pemphigoid. However, this is not widely being used in clinical practice. One of the caveats in bullous pemphigoid is the absence of the vesicle, as I said. So you should be able to pick it up in the urticarial stage where you don't see vesicles. The spongiosis is very mild and scanty eosinophil. It's only the index of suspicion, the age of the patient, that should trigger you to do an immunofluorescence. Now, this was a case which came as a prurigo. This patient presented with long-standing prurigo. It was an elderly patient. And of course, it did fit in with prurigo. You could see the infundibular hyperplasia, the hypergranulosis, the infiltrate, and the vertical streaking of collagen. But there was one subtle clue here. That is the presence of so many dermal eosinophils, the slight spongiosis, and the eosinophil sticking to the basement membrane, and the DIF positive for C3. This was a case of pemphigoid nodularis. The other variant of bullous pemphigoid that one sees is the pemphigoid gestationis or the herpes gestationis, which is generally seen in the pregnancy or puerperium. Again, urticarial lesions predominate. And this is characterized by intense deposits of C3. Generally, you don't get deposits of IgG. And this is confirmed by complement fixation in direct immunofluorescence. Moving on to the group of subepidermal cell-rich blisters with neutrophils. What you see here is a small cleft. You can't even call this a blister. This is a tiny cleft that has neutrophils. There are some neutrophils in the dermis. And what's classical is this dermal papillitis. That is, you have the neutrophilic abscesses at the tips of the dermal papilla. And the IF, of course, being this granular pattern at the tips of the dermal papillae, gives away the diagnosis. So this is a case of dermatitis herpetiformis, and it is very rare for you to see intact blisters in dermatitis herpetiformis because it's an intensely pruritic disease, and by the time the patient comes, all you see are excoriations. Gluten sensitivity is present in almost all the cases being reported in the West. And it is not so easy to get a positive DIF in dermatitis. I'll come to that in a little bit. And the ELISA anti-TTG and endomycial antibodies are available. Now, are we missing dermatitis herpetiformis because we are adhering to the criteria that are given by the Western literature? Now, there was a study from Dr. Hashimoto's group in Japan. So they've characterized more than 90 patients over the last 35 years. And these were all serologically confirmed cases of DH. And they found two particular patterns. That is, there was a granular pattern as well as a fibrillar pattern. And they found that the incidence of gluten-sensitive enteropathy is less than 1% in such patients. So my guess is that probably our patients also fit into this category. And DIF is, it's very, very tricky to get a positive DIF, especially if one takes a sample that's too close. So people have tried taking normal skin away. They've tried taking sun-protected skin, but still the sensitivity of DIF remains low for dermatitis herpetiformis. Now, on the contrary, what you have here is a much larger subepidermal blisters with a lot of neutrophils. So you're seeing a lot of neutrophils, and this is showing a linear deposit of IgA, and this clinical appearance is very, very classical. The cluster of jewels or the string of pearls appearance in a young patient. So this is linear IgA disease. Very often it's drug triggered, vancomycin is the culprit. And you either get only neutrophils or a combination of neutrophils and eosinophils. And on DIF, the dominant deposit is IgA with or without immunoreactants. Sometimes you could get a full house pattern that mimics LE. And in such a case, during an indirect IF, it will show positivity to PP180 and a roof pattern on salt split stain. Now, this is the differential diagnosis between DH and linear IgA. So the difference is in the clinical appearance. The histology could look similar, but the IF is different because there you have granular IgA and here you have linear IgA. Okay, it's time for the third quiz now. So this is a young boy who presented with these cluster of jewels appearance. So he had these grouped vesicles on the body, on the neck, some on the and this is what the histology showed. There's a large subepidermal vesicle that's rich in neutrophils. There's some subtle clues here. So along with the neutrophils, there's also a little bit of karyorrhectic debris or nuclear dust. And you could see this subtle dermal mucin. I'm not showing you the Alshin Liu, then it would become easier to pick up. So I have to appreciate it on the H&E. And this is what the immunofluorescence showed. It showed a linear positivity for IgG, IgA, and IgM. So could I have the diagnosis, please?
Audience, 30 seconds is all you have. Okay, Dr. Rashmi, Dr. Rohini are for chronic bullous disease of childhood. Dr. Chaitra and Dr. Anisha are for bullous lupus erythematosus. And Dr. Pathology is for linear IgA. Yeah, that's about it now. Dr. Deepika, Dr. Shivangi, Dr. Florescence are are all for bullous lupus erythematosus or linear IgA. Over to you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So I think yes. So this patient had a positive ANA and dsDNA. So I think that made the diagnosis simpler. And we also did a and C1Q is sometimes useful in predicting patients of systemic lupus, they say, but we have seen positivity in patients who have cutaneous limited LE also. So we won't use that criteria to differentiate. But yes, that is bullous lupus erythematosus, which we have to keep in mind. Now, bullous lupus erythematosus is of two types. One is where you get a blister just because the vascular alteration is extensive. The second, which is actually an autoimmune disease similar to EBA, because you have antibodies developing against collagen 7. So it's basically an autoimmune disease on an autoimmune disease, right? So what gives you clues is the nuclear dust of neutrophils. We've seen that there's always some keratin debris and dermal mucin. It's very good to do mucin stains. And if you see a lot of dermal interstitial mucin, you should think of it. DIF is necessary. And of course, on an indirect IF, you get a flow pattern on the salt split skin because the antibodies are directed against collagen 7. Right. Now, coming to some of the subepidermal cell-rich blisters that contain lymphocytes, here is one case. What you're seeing here is confluent epidermal necrosis because the epidermis has been suddenly detached from the underlying dermis. And you see these clusters of necrotics and you see mostly lymphocytes, some neutrophils, and the typical clinical appearance, some blistering, targetoid appearance, acral involvement. And this is in the group of erythema multiforme and toxic epidermal necrolysis. Now, EMF, SJS, TEN, it's a clinical distinction. All of them can show confluent epidermal necrosis. So that's something as pathologists that we have to remember. And what caused the EMF? Is it related to herpes or is it related to drug? That's sometimes a little difficult to say based on the histology alone. And clues to drug-induced EMF could be the combination of eosinophils and neutrophils, acrosyringeal involvement, and the presence of dyskeratotic cells. The differential diagnosis, of course, would be a bullous drug eruption. You need a positive drug history for this. Confluent epidermal necrosis, deeper dermal infiltrates as compared to what you see in EMF. And here you're seeing acrosyringeal involvement in the form of lymphocytes sprinkling the epithelium and basal vascular alteration, a lot of extravasated RBCs. So these are the clues that you could be dealing with a bullous drug eruptions. And drug eruptions, of course, could mimic any of the pattern. They could be acantholytic, they could show ballooning, they could show spongiosis, as well as they could show subepidermal blistering. So that's something which you always have to keep in mind. Now, coming to the category of subepidermal posse inflammatory or subepidermal cell poor blisters. So what you're seeing here is an empty blister and there's practically no infiltrate either in the content of the blister or in the dermis. It looks very clean. And what I draw your attention to is this feature, right? The fact that the dermal papillae are so well preserved, this is called as festooning of the dermal papillae. And on IF, this is what the case showed. You have this glassy deposition of IgG around the vessels and also a little bit around the basement membranes. And this child had lesions predominantly in the exposed sites. You can see a couple of intact vesicles, but mostly they have all healed with scarring and hypopigmentation. And sometimes you could also get melia in this disease. So this is an example of porphyria cutanea tarda. So this is exclusively on sun-exposed sites. Sometimes caterpillar bodies may be seen, which are nothing but basement membrane material that's sticking to the roof of the blisters. You could use a PA stain to show deposits around the vessels. But what's important to remember is that histopathology alone is not enough because pseudoporphyria, which is seen in some of the drugs and also in diabetics, looks exactly the same. So you need correlation with urine porphyrin levels. Okay, we come to quiz number 4. So this was a middle-aged lady and she had kind of lesions. You can see there is some amount of scarring that's happening. And also you see these vesicles and you see they are mostly on the pressure points. So she had these very fragile blisters that would rupture and that would heal with a little bit of scarring, hyperpigmentation. And this is what the histology showed. It was a cell poor subepidermal blister. There were a few lymphocytes, but not significant. And this is what the DIF showed. So there was a linear positivity for IgG as well as C3 in the basement membrane zone. So my question is, what is the next step? I don't want your diagnosis. I want to know what you would do next. Could we ask him to type in the answers?
They're already typing in.
Okay.
Dr. Rashmi, Dr. Rohini, Dr. Manoj, we don't need the answers. We need what will be the next step. Yes. Dr. Shivangi, Dr. Florence, Dr. Ran, Mehboob, and Dr. Anisha, they're all for salt split skin. And Dr. Mihika is for indirect immunofluorescence. Anyone else? Dr. Anthony, salt split skin. And Dr. Deepika, Dr. Vimal. Most of them are for salt split skin, ma'am. And Dr. Mihika is for immunofluorescence.
Okay. So should we proceed?
Yes, ma'am, please stop.
Okay. So I think those who said salt split skins can give themselves a little pat. Yes, salt split skin would be the next step. So what is the utility of salt split skin? What exactly does it do? So basically what is done here is the sample that is sent for DIF, it's immersed in 1 molar sodium chloride solution, which is freshly prepared for a period of about 48 to 72 hours. And what this does is that it induces a blister at the level of the lamina lucida. Remember, we said that's the most pliable of all the layers. So the pemphigoid antigens localize to the roof, and the antigens responsible for EBA and some of the variants of mucous membrane pemphigoid, they localize to the floor of the blister. So this is the utility of doing a salt split skin. Now, there are a whole lot of diseases. Some variants of pemphigoid also localize to the floor, but they're very uncommon in clinical practice, so I'm not going to dwell on them. So this is the utility of doing a salt split skin. So let's see what happened to this case. So we did a salt split skin, and the localization was to the floor of the blister. So we concluded that in correlation with clinical findings, at that point, we still did not have the indirect immunofluorescence. We concluded that this was most consistent with EBA. So EBA has two clinical forms where you have fragile blisters, which are induced by trauma on pressure sites, and you also have bullous pemphigoid-like tense blisters. Now, they could either be cell poor or they could be neutrophilic blisters. What you see on DIF is the same as what you see in bullous pemphigoid, whereas indirect IF, it shows a floor pattern on salt split skin. The antibodies are directed against collagen 7, which is similar to what happens in bullous LE. If you don't have salt split skin, is there anything you can do on the DIF pattern alone? Yes, provided you have a section that's pretty thin, cut at 3 or 4 microns, you could look for serration patterns. So you have an N serration pattern, which is described only in bullous pemphigoid and not in any of the other diseases. And you have the U serration pattern that has been described in EBA and the bullous LE. So this is something which we've just started looking at this, and I can tell you it's not very easy to observe it. So this is something we've tried to just take a photograph of that. I'm sorry, I should have taken it in oil immersion. Perhaps it would have been better then. So the serration pattern analysis is something you could look at while you're interpreting your DIF. So the next time you're looking at bullous pemphigoid, please start looking at the serration patterns. Now, coming to the indirect immunofluorescence using the biochip mosaic, I told you that this is what we are using in our department because we find it very easy to identify multiple substrates in a single run. You can run multiple samples. This is a titer plane technique which has the following 6 substrates: the monkey esophagus, the BP180 and 230, which 230, desmoglein 1 and 3 are on transfected cells. And BP180 is a recombinant substrate, and you have the human salt split skin. So each of the wells, so this is, you get 3 wells, 5 wells, and 10 wells. So you could use any of them depending on your sample load. This is what the biochip will look like. Now, I just like examples of how we use the biochip to solve some of the problems. This was an adult lady who presented with blisters with a past history of lichen planus, right? So the most obvious diagnosis was bullous lichen planus. But when we looked at the biopsy, the one from the lichenoid lesion looked like typical lichen planus. But when we looked from the blistering area, we found that there was a subepidermal blister. And although the blister per se did not contain too many cells, there were a lot of eosinophils in the dermal infiltrate. And this was the IF. We asked for an IF, and that showed a C3 pattern. And this is what the biochip mosaic showed. It had a roof pattern on salt split skin, and the BP180 was positive. This is what we like to call as the fluorescent Kaju Katli sign. So this is BP180 positive. So this is of lichen planus pemphigoidus, which we perhaps would not have identified if not for the biochip mosaic. It's a very rare disease. Less than 100 cases have been described, but we've been fortunate to see about 14 cases in the last 10 years. And the pathogenesis is that the interface dermatitis in lichen planus exposes the hemidesmosomal antigens. And we've observed that there are three distinct histopathologic patterns. One is LP-like, BP-like, and an EMF-like pattern. And we have to remember that eosinophils are not always evident. Therefore, a high index of clinical suspicion and immunofluorescence is mandatory for patients who have coexistence of lichenoid and bullous lesions. So this was a case of lichen planus pemphigoidus. Of course, the differential diagnosis is the more common bullous lichen planus, as you're seeing here. This is a typical lesion of lichen planus, but with just the clefting, which is very prominent, so it has become a blister. Now, this was an elderly man with pruritic erythematous lesions. He did not have any vesicles. So the question was for urticaria. There was no DF done. And the biopsy showed spongiosis with many eosinophils. If you can see, there are a lot of eosinophils, some neutrophils, and you see these eosinophils which are adherent to the epidermis. So we said, fine, this looks like an urticarial stage of bullous pemphigoid. And since a DIF was not done, this was an elderly patient, we said, okay, it's easier to take a sample for an indirect immunofluorescence. So why don't you send us some serum? And to our surprise, this is what we saw. We saw a fishnet pattern on the monkey esophagus, and desmocline 3 was positive. And it was negative for the bullous pemphigoid antigens. The salt split skin did not show any staining. So this was actually an urticarial lesion of pemphigus vulgaris, which underscores the fact that urticarial lesions of PV and BP look the same, and you need DIF and indirect IF to make the distinction. Now, this was a case, again, a subepidermal blister with neutrophils and negative DIF. When we did a biochip IF, we saw that there was a roof pattern, and the BP180 was positive. So this was a case of neutrophil-rich bullous pemphigoid. Now, this case was an elderly man who presented with erosions of the scalp and focal hair loss there. So the question was for DLE, and we got the biopsy from the scalp. If you look at it, you can't even say it's from the scalp. There are no adnexal structures. The epidermis is so atrophic. There's a subepidermal blister. There is fibrosis. And along with the fibrosis, you could see that there are a few plasma cells and eosinophils in the infiltrate. We did an indirect immunofluorescence, and what we saw was that the salt split skin showed a roof pattern. We found BP230 positivity. And on the day we got the biochip report ready, this man also started having mucosal lesions. So this was a case of mucous membrane pemphigoid, which was formerly called the cicatricial pemphigoid. This is very, very important to recognize because ocular involvement occurs in a high number of patients, leading to blindness. And those cases which have a laminin 332, that is those which have a flow pattern, they have a paraneoplastic significance. So this could either present a subepidermal blister with neutrophils or eosinophils. And if the biopsy is taken very late, it will show only scarring. In this case, we were lucky in that the indirect IF was positive, but more often than not, indirect IF is negative. So this was a case of mucous membrane pemphigoid. So to summarize the morphologic approach in subepidermal diseases, we looked at the inflammatory cases, the posi-inflammatory cases, the inflammatory cases where we had the eosinophils, the bullous pemphigoid group, the neutrophils, we looked at DH, we looked at LAD, we looked at bullous LE, and we looked at mucous membrane pemphigoid. We looked at some of the lymphocytic subepidermal blisters and also examples of posi-inflammatory blisters. Now, with this, I would also like to present an algorithm for the immunodiagnosis of intraepidermal diseases, which is relatively easier because fishnet pattern is more or less indicative of the pemphigus group. If you have only IgG and C3 without basement membrane zone pattern, it's pemphigus, and then you look at where the level of the split is. If it is with basement membrane zone pattern, think of paraneoplastic pemphigus. You could do IIF on a rat bladder substrate, but confirmatory ELISA for Plaquins is recommended, and you have to look for a neoplasm. And if it's presenting, if it has an IgA pattern, subcorneal pustular dermatosis, and we know that ELISAs are available for desmoglines 1 and 3 and envoplakin, these are commercially available ELISAs. DIF, of course, is negative in Dariae, Hailey-Hailey, and Grover's disease. Now, the algorithm for immunodiagnosis of subepidermal bullous diseases, this indicates the eosinophil-rich diseases, it indicates the neutrophil-rich diseases. If you have a linear pattern of C3 or IgG, end serration, think of bullous pemphigoid, eusserration, think of EBA or bullous LE. And the next step is to do an indirect IF on salt split skin, or you could do a serology. Look for a roof pattern or a flow pattern. The granular deposit, you will look for IgA, it's dermatitis herpetiformis, two or more immunoglobulins, including IgM, think of bullous LE. Oh, and I forgot to mention, if you have IgA pattern, it's linear IgA. Are available for BP180 and 230, collagen 7 and TTG. I'd like to leave you with these two cases that really had us a bit foxed. So this was a 10-month-old baby who presented with bullous lesions. You can see that she has bullous lesions, and she also has this slightly elevated lesions over here. And the question was whether it's bullous impetigo or the epidermolysis bullosa group. And unfortunately, we got a very small biopsy. We saw this case in consultation, and the doc was almost getting exhausted. We saw that the epidermis is completely separated. It's lying separately, and you have this tiny bit of tissue with some infiltrate in the dermis. Now, what I want you to do is I want you to identify what stain this is and give me the diagnosis.
Requesting audience to please type in your answers. The stain and the diagnosis. You'll have 30 seconds for that. Dr. Rashmi Jindal says GIMSA and mastocytosis. Dr. Deepa is also for Dr. GIMSA. And rest all, most of them are for toluidin blue. The diagnosis most are suggesting is mastocytosis.
Okay, so I think they're right. So this is indeed the toluidin blue. And that was a case of bullous mastocytosis. So just like you need out of the box thinking, sometimes you need to think outside the blister. So that's what we learned from this case. Now, the last case that I'm going to show you, this looked almost normal. This was all I'm going to tell you, that this was from a very young child. And when I looked at it on scanner, it looked almost normal, except for some autohyperkeratosis. But when I put it under the higher magnification, what I noticed, very subtle acantholysis in the granular layer. Do you see that? This slight acantholysis, right? You can make up. And also, when I looked closely at the rest of the epidermis, there is very subtle acantholysis. You see this, in fact, you could call it incipient acantholysis. It almost mimics spongiosis, except for the fact that there was no inflammation here at all. There's not a single cell. So there is this very subtle acantholysis, occasional dyskeratotic cells here. So anybody wants to hazard a diagnosis on this? A child. I'll tell you this was a child.
Pediatric patient, any answers, audience? Dr. Jayalakshmi suggesting Grover's. Dr. Chaitra Naveen is epidermodysplasia verusiformis.
Okay.
Anybody else? Dr. Anisha is suggesting chronic Buller's disease of childhood.
Okay.
Anybody else? That's it, ma'am. I think you can take over.
Okay, so I think we have a variety of blistering diseases that have been suggested, differentials. So what I'm going to show now is I'm going to show you the clinical picture. This is what the clinical picture looked like. So now would anybody like to revise their diagnosis after seeing the clinical picture? There are absolutely no blisters, no vesicles. This is what the child came with.
Okay, press set of diagnosis now. Anybody, Dr. Vimal J. John is for Hailey-Hailey's disease. Any other diagnosis? Dr. Rashmi Jindal has now revised the diagnosis to epidermolytic hyperkeratosis. Dr. Vanita Pandey is for the Dahlia's disease.
Okay, so I think whoever said epidermolytic hyperkeratosis is sort of on the path, but not completely. Now, this child, it's actually a much older child. It's actually a four-year-old child, but you see that there is stunted growth, there is wasting, there is palmoplantar keratoderma. This child was a collodion baby, and you are seeing this very subtle acantholysis. At least this was the first time I heard of it. This is a case of SAM syndrome. Confirmed because the mutations in the desmoglein 1 gene were confirmed by PCR, and this stands for, it's an eponym which stands for severe skin dermatitis, multiple allergies and metabolic wasting syndrome. It's a very rare disease which was described in 2013, and this has mutations in desmoglein 1 and desmoplakin genes which compromise the epidermal barrier functions, and it's a mimic of pemphigus foliaceus and the staphylococcal scalp skin because it's occurring in children and it's occurring in the granular layer. So the lesson that we learned from this case is that CPC is the final frontier. So pick up the phone and ask your dermatologist if enough clinical information is not given, whether they are thinking of a blistering disease or not. So that would be very helpful. So to conclude, in common practice, histopathology and DIF identify most of the vesiculobulous diseases. We have to understand the diagnostic limitations in subepidermal bullous diseases because these expensive specific investigations may not be available to everyone. But what everyone should consider doing is the derm mosaic biochip, because this is a very useful one-step screening tool. And at least it will reduce the need to go for expensive blots every time. At least the straightforward cases will get solved. And you could sort of use it to filter the ones that need further ELISAs. And as far as immunologic and molecular data in Indian patients is concerned, there is not much that's available. You mostly have anecdotal reports. And there is a lot of scope for future research for those interested in bullous diseases to take up this topic. And I hope that there'll be a lot of good information that's coming out of it. So thank you, KCIIPM, for this wonderful opportunity. And I'll be failing in my duties if I don't thank these two wonderful teachers of mine, Dr. Almut Buer from Dermatologicum Hamburg and Professor Dieter Metzer from University of Münster. And of course, all my colleagues in the Department of Dermatology and Pathology. You see borders in between the pictures here, but we don't have borders between our department, which is what makes it very nice and makes us more useful to the patient. So that's communication and clinicopathologic correlation are the basis to reaching a correct diagnosis. So with this, I end my presentation. Thank you very much.
Inchira ma'am. Rajlakshmi ma'am, thank you for that such a lucid presentation. We are getting a lot of congratulatory messages for such a lucid and a comprehensive talk. It was absolutely clear and we all enjoyed it. Inchira ma'am, any questions from the audience?
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Rajlakshmi. It's a very comprehensive and lucid talk, especially this being such a vast topic. This was such a vast topic with both autoimmune bullous diseases as well as non-immune bullous diseases. You brought in a good blend of both because you covered most of the non-bullous diseases in your differential diagnosis while you were discussing the cases. That was really good. And just before we go on to the questions, as you said, morphology is the first step in, you know, proceeding towards a diagnosis of a vesicular bullous lesion. But often because of regenerating epithelium in a bulla, especially our juniors or residents get stuck whether, ma'am, is this really an intraepithelial bulla or is it a subepidermal with regeneration? So could you highlight some points and give some tips how you could actually differentiate these two?
Okay, so yeah, I think that is a lesion. I mean, that's a problem that many of us face because what this ideally is, blisters should be biopsied. Well, that's nice to say in textbooks, but it's practically difficult to do. So especially of pigus, very often you see that the suprabasal blister regenerates and it appears intraepidermal. But you do still see some amount of acantholysis which is present there. And the same thing with bullous pemphigoid too, it appears intraepidermal. So what I would suggest is don't look at the middle of the bulla. Go to the sides, okay? Go to the sides where you would expect the earliest changes. The other thing one could do for additional clues is that you do get perilesional skin for histopathology. I mean, for DIF, isn't it? And we don't look at the pathology of that. So very often there are times when we've gone back, when we've not found specific features in this, we've cut H&D sections on the remaining perilesional skin and we've managed to solve the mystery. So look at the side of the bulla and don't focus on the regenerative changes is what I would say.
Thank you. And what would be the role of C1Q in cases of subepidermal neutrophilic bulla?
Okay. Okay, now this is, I mean, there's a lot of in literature used in our lab. It is not of much diagnostic value in a positive. So making a diagnosis based on C1Q positivity alone is not the right way to do it. You have to look for the presence of two or more immunoreactants, including the IgM. And some of them have started using C1Q as a marker to say which of the patients are going to go on to develop systemic lupus. But I think this is still something under evolution. And once we start doing it on a routine basis, we will have more information. But definitely, as a single marker to decide whether it's LE or not, no, we should not be using it.
Okay. So there are some questions from the audience as well. Dr. Jayalakshmi would like to know, how should we do quality control of DIF? Any pointers for that?
Okay. Yeah. So in a utopian world, we have to run positive controls and negative controls for DIF, but that it's not possible. So what I is, this is something IgA, IgM, C3 and IgG is something which you are running routinely. So I don't think you have a problem for IgG and C3 because routinely your pemphigus cases and the bullous pemphigoid cases
I think we lost you there.
Yeah. lost ma'am there. I think she'll be back. Yeah, ma'am, please switch off your video and I can just stop it. Rajlakshmi ma'am, please switch off your video. Yeah, yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So I'm switching off my video. Can you hear me?
Now, yes. Now Raji. Yeah.
Okay, fine. So the problem we face with IgA, because we're not sure whether it's truly negative. I don't think it's feasible in a routine lab to run, controls very often. But what I would suggest is look at the clinical and of course, if you have indirect immunofluorescence, you could correlate with that, or you could participate in an interlab comparison program. So that is what I would recommend.
Okay. The next question is, I think it is related to indirect immunofluorescence. Dr. Jayalakshmi would like to know what is the ideal antibody titer to proceed with indirect immunofluorescence, and maybe a few tips on the technical aspects of indirect immunofluorescence.
Okay. So the only indirect immunofluorescence that we do in our lab is the biochip, which is done in a 1 in 10 dilution. So we are doing, and that is the easiest method. The other thing would be, of course, some of them might be using only the salt split substrate. So we do not do titrations on indirect immunofluorescence for Bullous diseases. I'm not sure whether you're talking about the indirect IF dilutions for ANA or you're talking about Bullous diseases. That's not clear. But for Bullous diseases, we don't do it. The titers are given only in ELISA. So we don't give titers on the indirect IF.
Yes. Ma'am,
I have a question for you.
Yes.
Nephropath colleagues have started doing immunofluorescence on formalin fixed tissues also.
Okay.
Any experience with that from your side on dermpath specimens?
No. So far, we have no experience. I guess that would be a really last resort. Instead of doing that, what I would say is it's much better to take a sample for indirect immunofluorescence rather than trying to do DIF on formalin fixed. Because we have very sensitive assays that give us good results. So personally, in our lab, we've not tried doing this.
Done. Thank you. There are no more questions, ma'am. I think we can end it with the closing remarks from you.
Am I audible now? Switched on the video.
Yes, you're clearly audible, ma'am. Okay, please go ahead and make closing remarks so that we can close the session.
Right. So I just want to thank all of you for participating in this session. I know it's been a very exhaustive and exhausting topic, both for you to listen and perhaps for me also to put together this talk. And I think I've learned a lot in the process of what to do and what not to do. And one thing I would like to say is that for those labs which are practicing DIF already, I think time to go one step further. Try and do indirect immunofluorescence. You know, that brings in more specificity, and there might be diseases which we are missing because we are just doing DIF. So it's not a very difficult technique, especially the titer plane technique. So I would say that that's a good step to start with. Look at the profile of the Bullous diseases that you're getting and then build on that. So, and particularly to the residents, I know that this is a very difficult topic, and I hope that now there is some clarity and you all will be able to approach the blistering diseases with a lot more confidence now. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rajlakshmi, and thank you, Dr. Aditya, and our thanks to KCIPM too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Aditya. Keep up the great work. You're doing a fantastic job.
Thank you, ma'am, Sachin, for a wonderful talk. We learned a lot today. And for the audience, I would like to say that you can continue to post your queries in the comment section, and we will be happy to address them there itself. And this video will be available on YouTube all along. You can watch it anytime. You go back and watch it again if you want. Thank you all for joining us today. Thank you, Rajlakshmi, ma'am. Thank you, Inchira, ma'am. We'll be closing the session.
Yeah.